So we'll go ahead and call this Natural Resources and Parks Committee meeting to order. The first item on our agenda is a presentation by the Wildfire Project, and I'm so excited to have this group of hardworking and very creative people here to join us today from my hometown. They have really done incredible work. As my colleagues know, we've unfortunately suffered back-to-back summers of devastating wildfire in 2014 and 2015. But there have been some very inspirational things that have come out of that. And part of it has been a community conversation and really a grassroots effort that that this particular group has helped generate. And it's very exciting. I want to go ahead and start by introducing the folks from the Wildfire Project, starting with Jeff Austinson, the creative force, Sarah Rawls, the project lead coordinator, and Dr. Paul Hessburg. So Dr. Hessburg, if you can go ahead and come on up and we'll start the work session. Appreciate you coming.
Thank you, Senator Hawkins, and thank you all for being here. It's no secret that the West is experiencing an increase in large wildfires, especially those that are growing larger than 100,000 acres. We call these megafires. The total acres burned each year is increasing too. And today I want to talk to you about how we got here. In this graph, the blue trend line shows what it would look like if there was no year-to-year increase in area burned. Look at the actual increase in the last three decades. It's exponential, and climate data shows us this increase will continue. In fact, by 2050, acres burned will double or triple. So what's to be done about it, if anything? Well, there's a lot we can do. But let's understand how we got here first. It all starts in the forest. This is a mixed conifer forest in eastern Washington. A lot of us grow up with the notion that a blanket of trees is a healthy forest, right? But in reality, it often isn't. We've changed our forests, and that has changed the role wildfire plays on this landscape.
Fire is the biggest influence on the structure and composition of interior West forests, along with environments which are shaped by topography, temperature, precipitation, and solar radiation conditions. Wildfire strongly shapes three broad forest types. The dry forests, which typically get little snow and rainfall, are usually found at low elevations, on south-facing slopes, and on ridgetops. These areas are populated by medium to large-sized trees, which are spread far apart with open, grassy meadows beneath. Fires in dry forests occur frequently, are fueled by grass, shrubs, dead branches, and downed trees, and they typically do not burn very hot.
These fires may kill one-third to two-thirds of all the trees in an area. Because of the heavier snowpack and cooler temperatures, fires here burn very infrequently. The resulting patchwork of already burned, recovering, and maturing forest has a patchy feel to it, which prevents fires from spreading across large areas of the landscape.
In my lab, we wanted to take a look at this dynamic. So we reconstructed the vegetation conditions of about 400 Western landscapes. For example, cattle and sheep grazing had a huge effect on the landscape. By the 1880s, cattle and sheep herds were enormous, often numbering in the hundreds of thousands of animals.
Smaller fires combined into large storms of hellfire intensity. There was no stopping or containing the blaze. One could only hope to avoid it. Fire smoke reached as far as New England, as 3 million acres of timber, several towns, and 85 lives perished in 36 hours. The big burn cemented the Forest Service's future as the protectors of the forest. From that day forward, wildfire was declared a force to be fought at all costs. The inferno burned most destructive across vast swaths of slash left in the wake of the timber industry. This logging debris, coupled with extreme drought and weather and inexperienced firefighting, became a perfect storm that would forever change forest management and public perception of fire.
No workforce. They developed new technology and mobile infrastructure to support firefighting. By 1971, it was put them out by 10 a.m. and keep them smaller than 10 acres in size. And they got it done. And they were able to hold fires at bay for about 50 years. So think about 1935 to about 1985. And at this point, fuel buildup and more frequently occurring extreme fire weather events began to stop. This is when our forests started to become sick and unhealthy. So if you think about it, grazing with timber harvest and fire suppression, they all prevented fire from doing its job for about 100 years. Logging removed big old trees and the forest got denser and more layered. It's a bit counterintuitive though, isn't it, that removing trees would make the forest denser? But it did.
The fuel ladder is trees of all sizes and ages that connect the fuels on the forest floor to the canopy, and the fire will torch out into those larger trees. And that's why it functions as a ladder. This ponderosa pine is in perfect shape after all the fires in its history.
Fire seasons are 40 to 80 days longer than they were just 50 years ago. That's a doubling of the fire season in the worst years. That's a lot of exposure to fire. Let's revisit the forest that we started with at the beginning of the presentation. It doesn't look quite so healthy now, does it?
And we imported that idea here to North Central Washington, established the North Central Washington Prescribed Fire Council. We do need to bring prescribed fire back into the toolbox. In order to do that, we're going to need public support.
It's difficult to site a new sawmill without a stable timber supply. That's the current predicament in Eastern Washington. What's needed is social license to do the right kind of thinning work in the right places and to build long-term mill infrastructure where it is needed. Managed wildfire is another great tool, and it's grossly underused. Mr. Chairman, if I have a minute or two, I'll entertain some questions.
Well, you certainly do, Dr. Hessburg, and I just wanted to, again, thank you so much for all your hard work in the Wildfire Project staff for what you've done. It's been really personally inspiring to me, and I've had the benefit of attending numerous presentations and being a part of the community conversation, and frankly, it has led me to introduce the bill that is on the agenda today. So what you are doing and your team is beginning to really make inroads here at the Capitol, and it's really, really neat to see that how the conversation is starting to shape public policy. So thank you so much for that. If there are any questions from the committee members, I'd be happy to start. Senator Fortunato.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. How is the feedback from, we saw in your presentation that we had some environmentalists coming around to the fact that prescribed burning actually led to a more healthy environment and all that. Are we making progress in that regard, that it's being perceived better from the environmental community?
I think we are making progress. We're doing it through collaborative partnerships. There are dozens of them now throughout the West, and I think this conversation is getting smarter, it's getting more deliberate, and people are talking about using a broad toolkit and applying it in the right places with the right timing. So I think through broadening that conversation, we're making some headway in a way that was uncommon even 10 years ago.
Thank you. Senator Vanderweg.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. How I have two questions. The first one, how big an impact do you think it is having like monoforest where there's just a forest of the same species, a tree, and how much of an impact if we, in replanting, if we vary the variety of trees, would that have a substantial impact or would it be minimal?
It's a great question. If you look at the historical landscape, you'd see certain kinds of forest types where you had mostly ponderosa pine, for example, with some Doug fir scattered in there. If you look in the western hemlock Douglas fir forest, you see Douglas fir coming back after wildfires and then hemlock naturally coming in later on. Many forest types have mixed conditions, some of them initially, some of them eventually. I would say in the first 100 years of management, we planted after harvest an awful lot of forest back to single species. The good news is a lot of the mixes actually naturally came back, especially on the east side. A broadly distributed monoculture, though, is a recipe for problems with insects, for example, or diseases that really favor that host type. So those mixes are actually sort of, they help those kinds of diseases and insect outbreaks, they slow movement through the landscape where you have those species mixes. So.
Thank you. And the second question is, you mentioned reduced snowpack in the future, scientists make predictions of a much larger wildfires in the future. How much of that do you think is related to man-made climate change?
I think the climate warming, I've been a part of the IPCC reports for several decades now, and I remember when they first started predicting doubling CO2 scenarios, and it seemed in those days, 20 years ago, 25, that it was often the future. But it isn't often in the future before we've blown by some mileposts in eastern Washington, eastern Oregon, and I'm concerned that we undershot essentially how warm and how dry and how quickly it's going to happen. In forests in eastern Washington, for example, we're actually adapting to climate change because it's part of our world right now. So I believe the forecasts are not only real, but we're in it. My experience is in the West, we're in it right now, and it's something to be reckoned with. It's making the fires hotter, bigger, move faster. So it's this sort of perfect storm. You couple dense, layered forests, a lot of fuel, with conditions that are hot, dry, and windy, and you've got trouble.
Thank you, Dr. Hessburg. I do have a question for you because you shared a slide that was new to me, and we discussed this just a little bit earlier, but can you talk a little bit more about how Washington State stacks up to other states and a little bit about the relationship between either the relationship or just the comparison of data between the states that are conducting less prescribed burning and the wildfires in those states?
So these are grounded in the same data. They're basically looking at the prescribed burn acres. Is this the slide, Senator, that you were referring to? So it is basically saying that under the same EPA air quality regulations, the social license and the discord about fire and smoke has changed over a period of decades in some of these states. There's much more latitude, a more permissive role of prescribed fire that's being allowed, with the equalizer being the same air quality regulations across all those states. So an awful lot of it has to do with social license and working at it for decades, doing the prescribed burning, demonstrating the success, demonstrating reduced smoke associated with that, expanded social license, more acres treated. That's the primary difference. So the prescribed fire councils in these states that are leading
fishing, from recreational fishing stakeholders, we have two different panels to transition to. The first one will be, like, a call up Carl Burke, George Harris, and Bruce Larson, if you're available. Thank you so much, Dr. Hessburg. We appreciate your good work.